Thank you very much, Mr. Goenka, President of the Indian Chamber of Commerce. My colleagues, Mr. Jha and Mr. Sa from the Income Tax and Customs Divisions, Mr. Chatterjee, Mr. Singh, all the distinguished ladies and gentlemen from the Indian Chamber of Commerce. I see a lot of young faces, Shashwat. So I think that's the new element that's coming into the new Indian Chamber of Commerce now. But that's really delightful to see the baton pass on to the next generation. And I must compliment you for a year of glorious leadership that you have given to the chamber. I wish you well as you move on and your colleague takes over. And I'm sure the chamber will continue to engage with government, will continue to engage with different arms of the government, become a not only a bridge between government and trade and business, but also a thought leader to help us develop the agenda of New India that we are all working towards. And I have no doubt in my mind that if we were to all collectively make up our mind that we are not going to accept things the way they were, but are going to become the agents of change, the change that we wish to see in the country, the change that we always wanted to see in our country, the change that we hope somebody else will come and do in our country. I think the day we decide that we will become those agents of change, I think no power on earth can stop this country from achieving its true potential. And in that, my personal view, that your chamber can play a very important role. I think collective thought leadership that chambers and organizations which bring together captains of trade and industry can really play a very important role in defining the contours of tomorrow that we want to see. In fact, a small example which really reflects how times have changed for India. I mean, we all know that there was a point of time that China and India almost accounted for a major portion of world trade, and we see our own position today down to 2% or something in international or in world trade. But then let's take an example from where we are in Kolkata. I believe the Howrah Bridge was built in 1943. I'm told that 90% of the high tensile steel that was used in the Howrah Bridge was domestically produced, was made in India, 1943. And then more recently, and it's probably one of the world's most busiest bridges, I would think. The Howrah Bridge is an iconic structure. We had a Vidyasagar Setu come up more recently, I think in the 90s. The entire steel is imported. Howrah Bridge, I'm told, was built in 41 months. And you just reverse it. The Vidyasagar Setu was built in 14 years. 41 months, 14 years. That was what we gave to ourselves in the first 50 years of independence. Of course, there can be different schools of thought. One can say that at that point of time, the need of the hour was for largely public sector driven growth for the country, for the economy. And possibly for whatever reasons we accepted a certain pattern of developing the infrastructure of the country. And in that the private enterprise was largely stifled, was not allowed to grow to the extent many other countries who got independence around the same time of India did. Post 91, we started opening up the economy. We started engaging with the world with more openness. And clearly, we have moved on from the Hindu rate of growth of yesteryears into a more dynamic engagement between the private sector, government, and the public sector. But yet, I think we lost a lot of good opportunities along the way. As we opened up, probably we were too enamored by what was happening in other parts of the world, and we tried to clone too much of what was evidently being followed in other parts of the world. We opened up our economy for foreign investment. At one point of time, people used to say it's easier to get money out of the country than to get money into India. I think over the years, we've seen that changing, and we've seen more and more foreign inflows in different forms, and currently we are sitting with a good stockpile of over $400 billion in our kitty, which will hold us in good stead in the coming days and months, where the world economy is seeing some kind of turmoil, rising oil prices, the US economy rebounding, higher interest rates in America. But this is one time where we are eminently ready to face any adverse circumstances that we may have to address in the days going forward. But did we do enough in 70 years of independence? I think the jury is still out on that. Did we keep pace with the changing times? Certainly we did in a few sectors, but possibly not as much or as well as we could have or as we should have. There are success stories like the telecom sector, for example, where India leapfrogged into the most modern technologies and is today probably one of the best setups or networks anywhere in the world. Some data points suggest that we move more data in India than the United States of America does. What with everybody in every nook and corner of the country, and I very often try to go to the kitchen for a cheat snack late night, and I find that the domestics have still not gone into their quarters, are still probably watching television or watching a movie on their electronic instruments. I don't think we've given them access to the caravan as yet. It's still in the bedroom. But there are so many other sectors where we have huge amount of lost opportunities. After all, 70 years after independence, all of us will have to reflect, why should large sections of the population still not have a shelter of their own? Isn't it a matter of concern for all of us collectively that until 2014 we had nearly 25% of India's population who had never seen electricity in their lives? Children, generation after generation, not enjoying the fruits of development, a basic amenity like power. Clean drinking water, we are a far cry from what is desirable. Standards of education, standards of healthcare leave a lot of scope for improvement. Connectivity in terms of rural roads, particularly when we look at the aspirational districts or the erstwhile backward areas of the country, need a lot of thrust to really integrate the nation through physical infrastructure. And I think the last 4 years that Prime Minister Modi. Came into government since May of 2014, has seen a sea change in the mindset of the nation. Very often, media friends keep asking, what do you think is the single most defining feature of this government? And I'm often stressed to try and see whether our efforts to try and bring honesty and integrity or a corruption-free government is the most defining feature, or our focus on connectivity or different forms of infrastructure is a defining feature, or our effort to try and clean up the banking system is a defining feature, or the huge improvement in the macroeconomy and all the parameters related thereto is the most significant achievement. But the common thread in all of these, be it the Swachh India program, be it our Chandan program for financial inclusion, we have the chairman of Bandhan Bank here also, somebody who has taken banking to the doorstep of the remotest corners, particularly in West Bengal. Our thrust on digital India, on Make in India, Stand Up, Startup India, all of these, if there is a common thread moving through all of these beads in a necklace, if I often use to describe these various programs, it is the change in mindset. Have we to some extent been successful in changing the thinking of a billion plus people? And to my mind, the fact that we have a billion people aspiring for a better quality of life, demanding more from governments, be it at the center, be it at the state, be it at local levels, is truly the most important achievement of the last 4 years, where every citizen is now conscious that he can get a better deal from his country. And he's working and fighting and asking for more. Something like the Ye Dil Mange More story. And very often, at least in our internal conversations when we are talking, we realize how certain things get taken for granted. For example, in an area which is 25 kilometers from Patna, there's a place called Diara. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Patna. Maybe some of you may have gone to that side. Just outside of Patna, the Ganges, the Ganga flows. And across the Ganga, 100,000 people live. It's called a Diara. I don't know, must be the marshy lands or something. Until 3 years ago, nobody had ever thought that they could ever get electricity. When we launched the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana and decided that every nook and corner of the country deserves and must have electricity, one of the areas we focused on was this area. It falls in Mr. Rudy's constituency. I don't recall what is the Chapra, probably, or some area around Patna, and just 25 kilometers. So he used to tell me, people there are all the time watching Patna, just across the Ganga, brightly lit up at night. But they never imagined ki humko bhi kabhi bijli mil sakti hai. We took it up on mission mode. We ensured that electricity has reached that place, and I think almost every home there now has electricity. But then, And I don't want them all their life to be talking about it, certainly. But then the good part is that now that that has come, we forget that there ever was a problem of electricity. I mean, I don't know if any of you has ever had a discussion in your drawing room or at a pub or anywhere at all, that there used to be a time in the not too distant past when we were all the time struggling about when the power will come or when the power will go in large parts of the country. Having reached a situation where you almost are 100% surplus on power throughout the year, 365 days in a year, and we have an app, and I keep looking at Vidyut Pravah to make sure that we are having adequate electricity throughout the country. Having created a transmission grid that ensures seamless flow of power, so any particular place has an excess demand, we can move power from one to the other. Having already initiated significant projects, particularly towards South India, so that power can be easily transmitted down south, and ensuring that power is available throughout the country at roughly the same price on the power exchange, the one nation, one grid. I don't think today that's at all remembered or is a topic of conversation. And I think that's the best thing that could have happened to India. Not the fact that we all got power. The fact that the people are moving on. Okay, you've given us power, we all have power, we, by the end of this year, every single home in the country will have power. Of course, you'll have to apply for it. We won't come and thrust it into your home. So when we drafted the Saubhagya scheme, we rightly put it, every single willing consumer. Ek aadhe page ka application to bharwana padega. But the good part is that the world doesn't end there. The world begins over there. Because when we did a root cause analysis, we realized that unless we have power in every home, you really can't reach the fruits of development to every home. Unless you have financial inclusion and every home at least has the first single bank account. And then, of course, ideally every individual, every adult in the country should have his own bank account. Unless we reach that level of financial inclusion, we won't be able to do a lot of the other good things that can flow from there, both in terms of credit delivery, in terms of digitalization of the economy, in terms of formalization of the economy, and in terms of reaching the benefits of social inclusion or development to the last man at the bottom of the pyramid. And therefore, if you will see, each of the programs this government launched over the last 4 years have been to a plan. As I said, in the electricity sector, we realize you'll have to sort out first the fuel supply position. So we focus largely on what will happen with coal. Simultaneously, we realize we have enough generating capacity. In fact, a lot of stalled and stressed projects in that. So we stopped investing on the generating side, but focused our investments on distribution and transmission so that we can transmit through the length and breadth of the country, and invested largely in distribution to at least in the first instance take power to every village, the revenue villages. Second instance, take it to the hamlets. You know, those majlas, dhanis, tolas, which are around a village. Very often they are also called a village. But it's actually they are subsets of the main village, the revenue village. And having reached that stage, last year we launched Saubhagya, by which by end of December and with a little fallback, maybe up to March in two or three states, where there are challenges, where the figures were too daunting, Uttar Pradesh possibly, or some northeastern states. You would be a proud citizen of a country where every single home will have electricity in their house. And something which took us 70 years, but a large part of the last mile delivery happened only in 4.5 years. Cooking was a big challenge. Women all across the country using wood and all sorts of rustic methods of cooking. Prime Minister gave us a huge challenge that we should have at least 5 crore poor homes get the benefit of a free LPG connection. subsequently revised to 8 crores, and we are hoping that in the very near future, you will have every single home in the country, either the beneficiary of gas through a pipeline or through an LPG cylinder. The impact on the health of our women of this country will be so significant just by that one single Ujjwala program. But the Prime Minister doesn't rest there. With this rollout almost taking huge successful strides and slated for completion over the next 2 years or so, we have already started planning the next phase, which will take you one step forward from gas. So 3 weeks ago, or three weeks ago, we had a late night meeting on a weekend with all the top team of the government, sitting and discussing how we can, over the next 4 or 5 years, provide solar cooking with induction heaters, so that a poor person in his home will also be unburdened from the problems of gas and purchase of gas cylinders. And can we, over the next 4 or 5 years, ensure every poor household gets the benefit of solar electricity, a battery, an induction heater using that electricity, which can become the medium of cooking, and completely eliminate pollution from that house? He's already started working on that. Next step. And that's that mindset change. Can we be ahead of the curve? Can we keep planning ahead? What are the needs of this nation? After all, when we launched the LED program, I still remember there was so much skepticism all over. I remember we launched the LED program on 5th of January 2015. The Prime Minister launched it in his South Block office. He actually changed a bulb in the Prime Minister's office himself from an incandescent bulb to an LED bulb. I remember before this government came in, we had a company which was focused on LEDs and all other energy efficiency devices. They used to buy some 600,000 bulbs in a year. The price at that time was some 310 rupees plus taxes, plus marketing cost, distribution. The government used to give 100 rupees subsidy. And then that bulb, about 1 million bulbs at best, were sold in the country in a year. 1 million. Prime Minister Modi is very, very passionate about energy efficiency. In fact, very early on when I was Power Minister, he said, every unit of electricity saved in a country like India with 24% power losses is almost equivalent to 1.33 kilowatt hour of electricity generated. So it's more valuable than adding more generation capacity. We saw LEDs as a low-hanging fruit. But certainly, till it continued to have this 100 rupees subsidy, the amount of subsidy that we could give would always be the limiting factor of the scale at which you could roll it out. And B, the price itself was so large that the payback period was some 2 or 3 years. Very difficult to sell the proposition to anybody. And then people would plan to do a small rollout, so they would do, every household should replace 2 bulbs every year. And over the next 20 years, maybe we'll have 100% LED country. But that's not the way this Prime Minister works, unfortunately, for some of us who have to work long hours to keep pace with his demands. But fortunately for all of you, who will be the beneficiaries of his work. And he said, we will replace 770 million incandescent bulbs with LEDs in the next 4 years. Now go and do it. Go and do it. It's so easy. From a scale of 1 million a year, He wants you to do 770 million in 4 years. But again, he doesn't rest there. He keeps reminding you of this again and again. So I go to him for a coal auction discussion that I'm going to do this to give the coal mines out in an auction and this and that. And I'm just finishing the meeting and getting up, and he says, how many LED bulbs have you sold? I said, I don't know. I'll check up and let you know. He says, sit down. Kaam aise nahi hota hai. Agar results chahiye, to aapko monitor karna padega kaam kaise. Kitna ho raha hai, kab ho raha hai. Logon ko zimmedari deni padegi, zimmedar thehrana padega. You have to hold people accountable for what you had promised the nation. In fact, he gave me the example of the Jandhan Yojana. He said, Jandhan Yojana, mein, we opened some 130 million accounts in the first 4 or 5 months, if I'm not mistaken. So he said, aapko kaise lagta hai ye 13 crore account kaise khule? So I'm always quick on the response. I said, yeah, aap har cabinet meeting mein discuss karte the. Aur mantriyon ko bhi batate the ki aapke state mein थोड़ा स्लो चल रहा है जरा चिंता करो बात करो इसे नहीं नहीं वो तो मैं तुम्हें रिपोर्ट देता था कैबिनेट मीटिंग में मैं रोज सुबह 9 बजे वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंसिंग से रिव्यू करता था और जहां जहां लगता था कि ढील हो रही है स्लो चल रहा है उन बैंक मैनेजर्स से बात करता था पर्सनली एंड देन दैट मैसेज फ्लाइज इन द सिस्टम एंड पीपल आर एनकरेज टू डू मोर. It was that lesson that he gave me about monitoring programs and accountability that actually held me in good stead for the rest of the 3.5-4 years in terms of my ability to perform, my ability to deliver results. And in some sense, that has actually been the benchmark of this government's functioning. After all, if in 2014 we had about 358 kilometers of optic fiber laid in this country, 358, which is today upward of 3 lakh kilometers of digital fiber laid, optic fiber laid. 358 has moved to 3 lakh plus in 4 years. That's the scale at which work has happened. And to go back to the LED example, the first bulb was sold on 1st of May 2015. So we are about 3 years and 3 months, 2.5 months down the road. We have already crossed 900 million bulbs. Far more than the original target in much less time. The total investment in this whole project of the nation, the subsidy is zero. So your taxpayer money, which the government collects, has not been used to promote the LED program. Zero subsidy, 900 million bulbs replaced, payback period on these bulbs brought down to less than 3 months, prices are down 87%, with lumination going up from 7 watts to 9 watts. And against the total investment in these 900 million bulbs of $1.5 billion at best that the people of India have invested, the annual savings every year, year on year, in your electricity bills, and if any of you have not changed it in your business, I will have to tell the bankers to reconsider whether you deserve the next tranche of loans, because that's not the most efficient way of running your business if you haven't replaced it with LEDs so far. The country saves 45,000 crores every year on electricity bills just by these 90 crore bulbs. That's the extent of savings. In terms of carbon emissions, this has brought down carbon emissions by about 80 million tons of CO2. Every year. and we could avoid peak hour generation of nearly 20 gigawatts. Not good news for the Goenka family, certainly. But good news for all of us. And as Prime Minister Modi had declared in his first engagement when he was elected as the leader of the NDA, and formally the decision was taken that he will become Prime Minister, this has been a government that has been dedicated to the poor of the country. This has been a government that's dedicated to the farmers of this country. This has been a government that's focused in taking the benefits of development to the last man at the bottom of the pyramid. This has been a government that has tried to bring about a change in the lives of socially, economically deprived sections, marginalized sections of society. But certainly, this has been also a government which understands that all of you have an important role if we have to take these fruits of development to the poorest of the poor. You are that bridge which will add economic activity, which will create jobs, working opportunities, which will provide the revenue that governments need to meet their social welfare programs, and therefore, this has been a government which has, while on the one hand focusing its energies to uplift the quality of life of every single citizen in this country, also changed the rules of business to make it more transparent, to make doing business in India more honest, to clean up the banking systems, to clean up various avenues of, I think, to use a mild phrase, I'll stick to misdemeanors that were reported in business. I'm in Kolkata, so I have to be very careful with my choice of words. But I want to invite all of you to be a part of this changing mindset, to be a part of the new world that we are trying to create in our own country. I remember the last visit that I was in Kolkata, I'd also done a little bit of the Swachhata drive in certain areas. It's so amazing. I was at the Golden Temple yesterday. 100,000 people visit the Golden Temple every day. A month ago, I was at Tirupati. Probably more than that, visit Tirupati every day, or just about the same number. Spick and span, clean, absolutely. You can't find anything out of place in both these places. It's not as if only people who come to five-star hotels visit these temples, or mosques, or churches. It's just the mindset. It's just how we think. We wouldn't hesitate to throw the garbage on the street, but wouldn't throw it in our drawing room, would we? We wouldn't like a foul odor coming out in our home or from our toilets. Or if we were to come to the Taj and there was a foul odor in the bathroom, we would be hopping mad and screaming at the management. If they had not cleaned this hall properly, and if anything was out of place, the management of ICC would not have spared them. Are we equally conscious about the environment, about cleanliness, about disposal of waste when it comes to our industries, when it comes to our building sites? Are we providing the same amount of consciousness to safety, to standards of safety, to standards of environment? Or are our chemical plants liberally spewing out fumes and odors but we are not engaging with newer technologies or engaging with ways to reduce pollution because it costs money and affects our bottom line. But would not hesitate to have two more domestics in our home to keep our home clean, irrespective of added cost or budget. It's just the thinking that I'm trying to ignite in you. GST, something you always wanted, you always demanded, you always would plead with governments year on year. I think the first idea was floated when Mr. Vajpayee was Prime Minister, of a common tax in the country on the indirect tax side, after the success of VAT. Of course, we didn't win the 2004 election, so we could not take that agenda forward. But subsequently, since 2006-07, this kept being discussed for 7 or 8 years without success. And sometimes we are asked why we did not support it when we were in opposition and why did we implement it when we came in government. I think the moot point was that it was not being sensibly proposed. I was in the Standing Committee of Finance, and I remember asking questions of the government, then government, and clearly seeing that the way it was being proposed would be totally unacceptable to the people of India, to the states of India. And let me just give you one or two examples of why I think the earlier form of GST would not have worked with the country in a federal structure. You may all remember there was a thing called Central Sales Tax, CST. And since we are all honest taxpaying people in this room, I'm sure we've all paid CST. That rate used to be 4%. The central government had a phased plan to bring it down. So they said, we'll bring it down from 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 2 to 1, gradually phase it out, and introduce a goods and services tax in its place, GST. The agreement between the center and states was that as we bring it from 4 to 3, the center will compensate the states for their loss in revenue. Then from 3 to 2, they'll compensate further, and like that, 3 years they will compensate. And in 3 years, GST will be introduced. So there were two conditions precedent to the reduction in GST rates. One was the center will compensate you for 3 years. The second was that GST will be introduced in these 3 years. So this was a phasing out to prepare the nation for GST. CST was brought down from 4 to 3 to 2, and then it stopped at 2. GST never saw the light of day, kept getting discussed, no consensus was being built up. And 3 years passed, and the center stopped reimbursing the CST claims of the states, including of West Bengal. And it piled up, and states kept demanding that money. But the center never fulfilled their commitment. And in that process, the central government lost the trust of the states of India. And in the Union of India, in the federal structure, if GST ever was to be successful, the most important ingredient was the mutual trust between the center and states, which totally collapsed. And one of the reasons was the CST compensation. Government said 3 years are over, now we won't compensate you. The state said, but you never brought in GST. That was the condition number two. You have met half the point. The other half is not done. So we are at a loss because of this reduction of CST. And till we could generate that trust between center and states, it would have been near high impossible to bring in GST in India. And one of the first things, as I mentioned earlier, we do a root cause analysis before we do any work. One of the first things we realized was to build up that trust, the government will have to pay the pending compensation claims of the states. And you'll be amazed at the figure of claims that this government of Mr. Modi paid for earlier years in terms of CST compensation. 12,000 odd crores a year for 3 years, nearly 37,000 crores of state spending claims were paid by Mr. Modi and Mr. Arun Jaitley, thanks to which the states developed a trust in the Modi government. It's another matter that some of the states keep politicizing various issues. But isn't it a matter of pride for all of us in this room that the GST Council, a collection of 29 states, 7 union territories, union government has only one voice, 36 different voices with one union government voice, collectively representing almost every shade of political thinking and ideology in this country. So you have a Trinamool Congress, you have a Communist Party, you have Congress, you have TRS, the Telangana Party, you have TDP, the now very angry Andhra Party, you have AIADMK, you have others who are in combination, in coalitions with different parties. You had National Conference until some time back, then you had PDP. All political parties of different shades could trust Prime Minister Modi, could trust Mr. Arun Jaitley, could all come into one framework, could all decide on a legal framework, could all decide on the processes, on rates of nearly 1,200 items, which could be fit into one capsule, all of it unanimously. And there can be no better example of an accommodative center, of a center which truly positions itself as a leader of a union of states, works to build in consensus over meetings which at times would not only last 11, 12 hours a day, but days on end, but build up a consensus, assiduously work towards bringing all shades of opinion on one page, and successfully launch the GST in India in a defined time frame. 1st July will be 1st July. And there was a lot of talk, thoda postpone kar do, thoda defer kar do. It's like when I'm trying to address punctuality in the railways and I'm saying even a minute is late. And then they say, sir, but the railways is such a complicated task. 22,000 trains leaving from all nooks and corners of the country with a crumbling infrastructure, many times over 100 years old. You should allow us 15 minutes grace. I said, if we allow you 15 minutes grace, the 16th minute will become the 1 minute, the first minute. And that 16th minute, if that is going to be the first minute, might as well address the 1 minute which you are delaying. Similarly, the more you would have delayed GST from 1st of July, the more the problems would have only accentuated, not fallen. And I think within a year, the kind of success we have seen in GST is truly amazing. It's the first time anywhere in the world, a country of the size of India, a country with, as I said, so many shades of political opinion within the country, with a billion people, with over 10 million taxpayers, earlier paying 17 taxes and 23 cesses, all getting subsumed into one tax, seamlessly moving forward. Technical glitches came in huge number, but a responsive government addressed each of them proactively, smoothened the edges. And I think at the end of a year, I've been having different engagements in different cities with several chambers. I was in Bhopal barely last week, I think on Friday or Saturday, Friday, I think. I met with not less than 37 chambers of commerce or business associations who had come from Mandideep, Pitampur, Indoor, Devas, all over the state, Dhar, 37 associations. I personally wrote down 61 issues that they raised. I promise you, ladies and gentlemen, not one of them was something so game-changing or something so drastic that I should have had a cause of concern right away. There were some very good suggestions. Some suggested that the composition dealers could be allowed to give an annual return instead of a quarterly return. I think that's it merits consideration of the GST Council. We could have small taxpayers even been given, instead of a monthly, maybe a quarterly return. But then there is another set of people who give some ridiculous suggestions that there should be one rate of tax. It amazes me when this demand is raised of one rate of tax. I would love to see what will happen in the state of Karnataka and how the people of Karnataka will react if rich and poor, middle class or upper middle class, everybody in Karnataka was asked to pay an 18% rate of tax, a common one single rate of tax, and we get article upon article, we get public statement upon statement demanding that, oh, this is not a simple tax, this is not a true GST. A true GST should have only one rate of tax. And that rate would normally be 18% looking at the tax collection and the way the current rates have been determined, particularly the concessions given to items which are consumed by the poor. We would almost have a social and political revolt in the state of Karnataka. I don't need to clarify why I'm using Karnataka again and again. I could say Punjab otherwise. Or Puducherry or Manipur. Char mein simit ho gaya, ab to aur to koi raha nahi hai. Hai koi aur? Dhyan nahi aa raha. I don't know what the opinion of the West Bengal government is. I have not found out. Have they demanded a single rate of tax also? But I don't know if that leader who was going to connect all the MRI machines of the country and solve the health problems of India believes that Mr. Goenka's BMWs and Rolls Royces should be made significantly cheaper. Rolls Royce hai ki nahi hai? Nahi hai abhi tak. Chalo, Maybachs maybe. But I don't know if the agenda is that the billionaires of this country start paying less taxes and that burden goes to the poor of this country, that burden goes to the middle class of this country, who will then be required to pay 18% tax on their items of daily use, who will then be required to pay 18% tax on sugar and salt, who will then be required to pay 18% tax on the rubber chappals that they have to wear, who will then be required to pay 18% tax on a simple dhoti or a simple kurta that they could afford costing 100, 200 rupees, which may last them the whole year, so that the Mercedes-Benz, so that the aircrafts that people own, so that the cigarettes and tobacco that is consumed can be made cheaper in this country. And to my mind, that would be the worst form of government or governance that this country could ever give to its people. We believe in the ideology of Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay, in the ideology of Antyodaya, where the nation's resources should rightfully belong to the poorest of the poor first. They have the right to our nation's wealth, so that we can ensure a better deal of life for every child born in this country, so that we can ensure that every child in this country gets quality education, so that every senior citizen of this country gets quality healthcare, so that we can ensure that that new India that we are trying to create, that new India that is the dream of a billion people, where every citizen has a shelter on his head, every citizen has a toilet in his home, the least that we can give to our people. 24/7 power in his home, electricity. Clean drinking water. That alone will probably solve half your health problems in the country. Connectivity, and connectivity of all sorts. Roads, rail, air, internet, waterways. Good health care. I think what President Abdul Kalam had said, we will all have to work collectively to make our villages a better place to live in, so that we don't have a situation where in the search of a good quality of life, every villager, every young child in the village is forced to move out of his villages, is forced to live in terrible circumstances in the slums of large metropolitan cities or larger urban areas, just for that aspirational lifestyle that I think every citizen of India is entitled to. I'm sure all the members of this chamber will want to be a part of this new India, will want to engage with the changing face of new India, and will want to contribute to a better tomorrow for our children, a better tomorrow not only in economic terms, not only in physical terms, not only in social terms, not only in terms of a better environment, not only in terms of better healthcare, physical fitness, education, skills, but as a holistic individual, a country caring for comprehensive development of every part of this country, so that we can truly meet the aspirations of our teeming billion, of every single individual, every single citizen of this country. Ladies and gentlemen, I invite all of you to be a part, to be a participant, to be the face of New India. Contribute to that new country that we are all trying to work towards. Contribute to making development our mantra, going beyond parochial boundaries, but working collectively to a better future for our children, for the children of tomorrow, so that any of those young children on that table tomorrow don't ask us a question: what did you do for this country? What have you left behind for us? Thank you.